Ladies and gentlemen, I will introduce to you Team A, the subject of water policy and the cultural heritage. But first, I like to introduce myself. My name is Ellen Vreenigor and I work for the Cultural Heritage Agency in Amersfoort, which is a part of the Dutch Ministry of Education, Culture and Science. I currently work as a program manager on the priority task Cultural Heritage in relation to important water challenges in the Netherlands. The program addresses one of the five priorities in the policy document Character in Focus, Vision for Heritage and Spatial Planning, which is focused on the sea, the coastal area and the main rivers. As an introduction to the subject of water policy and cultural heritage, I should like to highlight two things. First, the relationship between water and the cultural heritage in the Netherlands through the ages, followed by the water challenges we now face and how the cultural heritage can help us address them. The defining feature of the Netherlands, the Low Countries, is its geographical location on a delta formed by rivers and the sea. As Voltaire put it in the 18th century, God created the world, except for the Netherlands. The Netherlands was and is created by the Dutch themselves, with a great passion for utility and beauty. Nowadays, the Netherlands consists of a flat river area, a flat river delta, molded by broad rivers like the Rhine, the Meuse, and the Scheldt that flows in the sea. Without dikes, 27% of the Netherlands would be submerged. Over the centuries, the Dutch have introduced a host of measures to allow them to live with all this water, like dams, dikes, draining ditches, wind and water mills, and stretches of water were turned into polders. Even names in the Netherlands reflect its relation with water. Names of regions and areas like Zeeland, Sealand, Waterland, and Wieringermeer, and place names like Amsterdam, Rotterdam, Kinderdijk, but also surnames like Van Dijk, Van Dam, Terpstra, and Poldermans show the relation with water. One might therefore say that dealing with water is in the Dutch DNA. Since prehistory, people been taking measures related to water. People lived near water, though far enough away or high enough on artificial mounds known as turps, to keep their feet dry. Peat bogs were made habitable by digging ditches through them, and they allowed the water to drain away until the land was dry enough to live and grow crops on. The first dikes and dams were built in the Roman period. At the spot where the Waal branches off from the Rhine, a dam was built to divert more water to the Rhine and the recently built Druses Canal. To allow goods and people to be transported long distance by water, a system of canals such as the Corbulo Canal was dug. The Romans built forts with their own harbors and on the river that formed the border of their empire. The road along the northern border, the Limes, was reinforced such that it also acted like a dike. Locks and culverts were built to compensate for the natural drainage that had been disrupted by dams and dikes. And in the third and fourth centuries, bridges were built across the river Meuse at Cuijk and Maastricht. In the medieval period, people again sought out the highest spots in the landscape or built a mound to live on, the so-called dwelling mounds, in Dutch, terps, wierde, woerden, werven. From the 13th century onwards, on a large scale, ditches were dug to drain the fen and peatland, which is still visible in the landscape. And large areas of land were reclaimed by building dikes to protect the new land from flooding, like the circular dike in West Friesland. Polders were drained using wind and water mills. A special organization were established to maintain the dikes and the ditches, the water boards, which took up the task in collaboration with farmers and the public. These were the first democratic organizations in the Netherlands. The oldest one, the Hoogheemraad Rijnland, dates back to 1255. Dams in the Amstel, Amsterdam, and the Rotte, Rotterdam, and sorts of clay applied to wet soil allowed people to live by water. Shoring up embankments and dikes, Nieuwe Dijk, Amsterdam, Voorstraat, Dordrecht, would create enough land for small settlements to grow into towns. The battle against water is part of the Dutch history. Again and again, the Dutch created polders and strengthened or moved their dikes. Many historical sources also refer to floods, some of which has disastrous consequences. This 15th century painting shows the St. Elizabeth flood of 1421, which severely affected the Dordrecht region and the southwestern delta. This picture is in the Rijksmuseum. From the 15th century onwards, large areas or polders were drained using a wind and water mill system like Kinderdijk. In the 17th century, Beemster, Schermer, Purmer polders were created, followed in the mid of the 19th century by the draining of the Haarlemmermeer, where Amsterdam Airport is now situated, which was achieved using the largest steam engine in the world, the Crucius. In the 19th century, also large hydraulic engineering structures, locks and pumping stations were built in the major rivers to allow the water level to be controlled more effectively. The Afsluitdijk, was 30 kilometers long, brings the Zuiderzee under control and was opened in 1932. A whole new province, Flevoland, was created on the new reclaimed land because the government undertook the huge operation of creating the IJsselmeerpolders. Technology was making the Netherlands safer and safer. The flood disaster of 1953, in which large part of the southern Netherlands were inundated, 1,836 people drowned and 72,000 people were made homeless, came as a huge shock. The government decided to launch the Delta Project, the ultimate example of collaboration between the government's hydraulic engineers and the Forestry Service landscape designers. The Delta Project was designed to ensure that flooding on such a scale would never occur again. By closing off the largest sea inlets and building barriers and locks, the future safety of the southwestern delta would be assured. People from all over the world came to admire the modern world wonder in our delta. One of the consequences was that people who had lived with the threat of water for centuries now felt so safe that they become somewhat alienated from the water. They want to live on a dike with a view over the water or even in the front of the dike. Living by the water became a new trend with no protection from flooding. Residential developments were built in low-lying areas with no thought as to where floodwaters would go. The land was paved on a large scale. Drainage systems were used on low-lying areas to use it as arable land, and streams were straightened so the water drained more quickly into the rivers and the canals. How great the contrast with the people from the preceding, who always had sandbags or partition boards at the ready. A rowing boat in the shed, a stone floor downstairs, and a stairwell that was large enough to allow the piano to be carried upstairs. Or who had grown used to the river flooding twice a year, filling the ground floor of their home with water. In the 1990s, the river Meuse in the southern Netherlands flooded because causing a great deal of damage. Elsewhere, dikes threatened to breach, which would have caused further flooding. After this wake-up call, a new flood protection policy was developed, with infrastructural works in the Meuse and measures to give river rooms to overflow without causing damage. The government also decided that a new Delta project was needed to make the Netherlands safe in the face of climate change, which is causing extreme peak water levels and salinization of groundwater, which in turn could lead to shortage of drink water and water for agriculture and horticulture. Plans were put into action with great enthusiasm, but no regard for the cultural heritage as a basic factor of importance. This is now being rectified. One response has been the Ministry of Education's Culture and Science policy document, Character in Focus. One of the priority concerns with water and heritage. It's called individual character and safety, which illustrate the fact that it is a matter of dealing with both water issues and cultural identity. We are taking three lines of action in order to achieve this: awareness, knowledge, and best practice. The cultural heritage must come to be seen as a support in spatial challenges involving water. It must first be brought to the attention of those who take the lead role in facing these challenges, so that they become aware that the cultural heritage is an inherent part of the challenge and must be involved in the process. The National Public Works Agency needs more practical knowledge of water-related heritage, such as maps showing known cultural heritage values, probable values, and disruption. Local and provincial authorities, water boards, and others need tools that allow them to translate that knowledge into rules, regulations, and conditions about what is and what is not allowed, how different types of cultural heritage should be dealt with, how it should be incorporated into planning maps. We provide necessary toolkits in matching projects. We generate examples of best practice that shows that by incorporating the cultural heritage from the very start, projects can become better, more attractive, proceed more quickly, cost less in the long run, and be more sustainable. It also creates more support for local projects in the immediate area. In this way, the cultural heritage can become an integral part of efforts to ensure the safety of the nation and preserve local and regional identity, to show that heritage is not a burden, but also an opportunity. So we can rightly say, heritage helps.